Congratulations on beginning your journey to becoming a midwife. I am Anna and this is Kath.
Anna and I are about to finish our degree and become registered midwives. So we're going to share today three documents with you that we feel that are important to you in your professional development. We have the National Competency Standards for the Midwife, the Code of Ethics and the Code of Professional Conduct.
Upon completion of this presentation, you will understand the role of the Nursing and Midwifery Board of Australia. You will have a working understanding of the codes and standards we are discussing today and how they can be applied to your role as a student midwife and a registered midwife. Through this presentation, there are also a couple of real-life scenarios that Kath and I have experienced. When these slides pop up, think about the situation, think about your reaction, and think about how you would act and what you would say in relation to woman-centred care, rights to self-determination, legal and ethical practice, and professional conduct.
So the Code of Ethics, the Code of Professional Conduct, and the Competency Standards are all written by the Nursing and Midwifery Board of Australia, or the NMBA. This is your national governing organisation and provides a framework of practice for registered midwives and student midwives. The NMBA is one of 14 national boards that work with the Australian Health Practitioners Regulation Agency, or APRA, to ensure that health practitioners from a wide range of fields meet the standardised training and performance objectives of the National Registration and Accreditation Scheme. That's another topic though, so today we're just looking at the NMBA codes and standards. The NMBA also works in partnership with APRA and handles complaints, investigations and disciplinary hearings. One of their primary roles is to protect the public, and this is done via their policies, their guidelines and their codes, the role in investigations and disputes, and their standardised approach to ensuring that all midwifery training and clinical experience for students meets the set standards.
The NMBA policies, standards and codes are not designed to be standalone. It is confusing to follow at first, so we hope this diagram simplifies how the codes support each other. For instance, the code of professional conduct for midwives in Australia and the Code of Ethics were written to complement each other. We will discuss how they support each other shortly. The Guide to Professional Boundaries goes hand in hand with the Code of Ethics, as ethics also encompasses professional boundaries. Above them all is the overarching framework, the National Competency Standards for the Midwife. The Code of Ethics and the Professional Conduct tie in closely with the Competency Standards, which means that all the other policies mentioned also feed into it. For your benefit, we have added in the Social Media for Midwives and Midwifery Students paper, because we think it is a very important document for new students. This is a guidance paper written by the Australian College of Midwives, and it relates to the professional conduct, professional boundaries, confidentiality and ethics. It is advisable that you read and understand this paper so you know your legal, ethical responsibilities should you feel the need to write a comment on Facebook about anything that happens on clinical practice, and so that you know your responsibilities should a follow-through woman friend you on social media. Finally, at the top of the competency standards, we have the National Midwifery Guidelines for Consultation and Referral. This is also written by the Australian College of Midwives, but deserves a special mention as a very important document you will refer to when identifying what women fall outside midwifery care and require medical assistance.
So now we're going to look at the National Competency Standards for the Midwife. So this document is what you're going to be mostly referring to in your assignments, and it outlines in plain language the core competency standards that newly registered midwives are assessed against and student midwives are assessed against in their clinical practice. To be able to maintain your yearly registration as a midwife, you must be able to demonstrate that you're competent against these standards. So as you know by now, midwifery is all about women-centred care, and this document breaks it down into four different domains. So the domains are what they say. So the legal and professional practice is all about the common law, policies, guidelines, safe work practices, working within the scope of practice and documentation. The midwifery knowledge and practice, that is all about working with women and their babies. Midwifery as primary health profession is about promoting midwifery care, advocacy, the rights and practicing women-centred care within that framework, and ethical and reflective practice is encompassing learning through reflection, ongoing professional development, and ethics. So as you will see with all of these themes in these documents, they are all very similar. They all use the same definition of the scope of midwifery practice, therefore it stands to reason that what you see is important in one document will reflect in other documents. For instance, legal, ethical, women-centred aspect of midwifery care. However, these three documents approach the topics from very different perspectives. So thinking about those domains and the principles, have a look at this scenario. It's a real life situation, and just have a think about what you would do in this instance.
Let's now take a closer look at the Code of Ethics for Midwives in Australia. Ethics is very much a reflection on behaviour. In fact, ethics refers to the moral principles that govern a person's behaviour or how they conduct an activity. Morals and ethics are used interchangeably throughout this document. The code consists of 8 value statements that address the standards and values of the profession of midwifery. Each of these statements address the implications for self, meaning the midwife, the woman and her infants, her partner and family, your colleagues, which are other healthcare professionals and students involved in the woman's care, and the community, referring to the Australian community as a whole and the woman's community in which she identifies through religion, culture, age, ethnicity, and gender. You will notice the themes in this document are very similar to those of the competency standards, only they are taken from the perspective of the midwifery profession's values rather than the attributes by which an individual is assessed against.
So now we're moving on to the Code of Professional Conduct. Like ethics, conduct means behavioural, and it means the manner in which a person behaves in a particular place or situation. So you can see how it overlaps by definition alone. The Code of Professional Conduct is broken up into 3 principles, being midwives practice competently in accordance with legislation, standards and professional practice. Midwives practice within a woman-centred framework, and midwives practice midwifery reflectively and ethically. Within these 3 principles, there are 10 conduct statements. Again, these principles relate to the legal and professional conduct, women-centred care, and reflective and ethical practice. Only this code focuses on the behaviour expected from a midwife personally and professionally, whereas we have seen previously that ethics focuses on the values of the profession of midwifery, and the competency standards focuses on assessment of the individual midwife, encompassing both ethics and conduct. So unfortunately, this is a real life situation that you may come across. So just have a think about the legal, ethical and the woman-centred attitude that you're going to have and what you think you might be able to say to a woman in this type of situation.
So to summarise, the Code of Ethics, the Code of Professional Conduct and the Competency Standards all tie together, highlighting the expected legal and professional obligations, ethical and reflective practices, and expectations within a woman-centred framework and the midwife's role in supporting women's rights to self-determination. Right now, you may not see the benefit of reflection, but continuously reflecting and being a lifelong learner will build your practice knowledge, skills, and provide you with up-to-date information that informs your woman in the latest evidence-based practice.
So we thank you for participating today in our presentation. We hope you found it interesting to reflect on your values, your beliefs and your biases, and how they may impact you on the way in which you respond to other people's circumstances from the 2 scenarios that we provided, and that these codes and guidelines will aid you in your practice to provide safe, respectful and women-centred care. So we wish you well on your journey to becoming a midwife.